Hello all, welcome back to this second session on this face-to-face interaction during the faculty development program on use of ICT in online and blended education. In the first session, you have actually seen the review of flipped classroom. You have actually done a pros and cons analysis of two flipped classroom strategies and have identified what all are some of the best practices that you can follow in a flipped classroom design. What you will be doing in this coming session is actually try to design a flipped classroom strategy in for your own course. So we know that many of you do not have instruction immediately, but in the coming semester, supposing you have a course in the coming semester, try to design a flipped classroom for the your own course which you are doing in the coming semester. We'll walk you through what is known as a flipped classroom activity constructor, which is going to help you in this particular design. You have actually done one part of it as a peer assessment activity in week one. So the week one assignment was about designing a think, pair, share activity for your own in-class activity. That is one part of the flipped classroom design. Today, across the two sessions, we'll be taking you through how to design this activity with the help of a document that we call as activity constructor. This activity constructor is meant to help you out in the design. It has specific guiding questions and comments on how to do it. It also has example submissions. So we have put up example slides which can be referred to while designing your own flipped classroom. So all these resources that we have, all these slides of today will be available in Moodle by end of today. Without much ado, we'll start moving on to the flipped classroom activity constructor. Some important points about the activity constructor. If you look at the bottom, you can see a CC by SA. So all these documents are shared through what is known as a Creative Commons license. This specific license means that it can be shared alike, it can be used by you for different purposes as long as you give attribution. So CC by share alike and with attribution. So you have to just attribute that this is from a faculty development program conducted by IIT Bombay. That's all what we require. Otherwise, you are all free to use this particular slides wherever you want to use it. Maybe another session that you want to give it to your students or to your colleagues, you are free to use it. So throughout this workshop, one more important concept that we will be focusing on is the concept of open educational resources. So whatever resource you create, it has to be open so that other people can also take the benefit, and provided they give you some attribution. So there are various Creative Commons licenses. We do not have enough time to explain it today, but try to go to the creativecommons.org to see what are the different types of licenses available. In case people were not listening to me, this is a Creative Commons share alike license. It is important because it allows the work to be shared among a lot of people, and it is a open education resource. So about this constructor, this activity constructor is aimed at assisting teachers in designing flipped classroom activity in their own course using existing content. So rather than you create new content, you look for existing content and try to create flipped classroom activity based on it. This guide will deal with open educational resources or those licensed under Creative Commons. There are various kind of licenses. Please go to the website of Creative Commons and look at what all each license means. A general guideline: the slides with these white lined background are information sheets, or they give you guidelines or possible information chunks that you want. There are some more slides with pale yellow or brownish background. They require you to provide inputs. So that is where you input, you provide your own input. So there are texts written in blue. You have to replace that whatever you want to input while designing. Such blue, yellow and blue combination will be followed by an example. So the first segment is about you, where you have to provide basic information about yourself and the topic in which you want to design the flipped classroom. So this is the yellow slide, the pale yellow slide that we were talking about. So here you can see text written in blue. So we'll be providing this constructor to you, and what you have to do is replace whatever is in the blue slide with appropriate inputs. So this instruction says replace header with name. The first text box says topic chosen for flipped classroom. The second is about course from which the topic is chosen. The third is the domain, target audience, and this is actually optional. If you want to put up your affiliation, you can even put that. So I'll just show you an example. I have created this slide. So you can see example written over here. Instead of name, you can see my name. This particular flipped classroom example that I'm talking about is about a small topic called Boolean expressions, which is common to both electrical and computer science faculty. I've taken it under a course called Digital Circuits, which comes under the broad domain of electrical. This is targeting second year UG students in electrical engineering. So I have specified who the target audience is. Now, in a flipped classroom, there is something called out of class segment. So this section will help you in designing the out of class segment. Today's lab activity is specifically in helping you out doing this out of class segment. So you will be using this flipped classroom activity constructor in the afternoon. About the out of class segment, it is out of class is meant mainly for information transmission to student, mostly help achieve lower order cognitive levels in revised Bloom's taxonomy called recall, understand and apply level. Teacher has to take some time to search and locate appropriate videos. For the first time when you do it, you will need some amount of time to search and locate appropriate videos for your own course. One important rule of thumb, out of class activity should not be too lengthy. For this particular faculty development program, we have given the instruction, ideally think of one lecture being transferred outside. So one lecture typically in colleges is of duration 1 hour. So your videos and associated activities should not be more than 1 hour duration, should not make students do more than 1 hour of work. So this is the first input slide that you have to work out. Listen to the instructions that are being said now so that you can fill it in the lab session. So we'll give permission to download shortly. First, you have to write the learning objectives of the out of class activity. And as the guideline says, typically provide learning objectives at recall, understand and apply level. Another important thing, what are the key concepts that you want to cover through this particular out of class segment? Typically the number of concepts should be very few at most. So 1 to 2 was the guideline. Maximum you can go initially is 3. So we know it is difficult to compress everything the first time around. So this is a starter's sheet. So here at the max, you can go to 3 concepts. So look at the example that I have written. This is the learning objective of the out of class activity. We'll talk more about these
levels and other things tomorrow. You have been already assigned 3 videos for tomorrow's session. So session 1 tomorrow is completely about how to align the learning objectives with appropriate technology tools. What is important to note is that I have only used 3 key concepts. So all my videos are related to these 3 concepts. Now, guidelines for video selection. First, you can check the national repositories. There are NPTEL's YouTube channel. If you don't find any content in this, there are international repositories like OER Commons, Open Courseware Consortium, or Open Learning Initiatives, which have courses, free courses, online courses. And if you don't find your content over here, then look into the video standard video repositories. Ideally, you should filter for Creative Commons license. So with your YouTube search or a Vimeo search, you have an additional component called filter. Choose this filter and select the Creative Commons license. It is important because some of the videos have copyrights. And if there are some copyright violations, you may be legally obliged to pay some financial compensation, or you may, the party whose video has been put up, they may file a case against you. So in order to avoid all these, that is why we always insist on this open educational resource. All these are open educational resources, particularly the OER, OCW and OLI. So the moment you create a Creative Commons license for your resource, thereby you reduce the legal complexity in sharing your content that you create. So go to YouTube, there is YouTube Education, there is Vimeo. Vimeo also has an education channel. And if you don't find any of these, there is World Wide Web. There is a site called Edutopia, which has a list of open education resource websites. You can even look into that. A normal Google search for open education resources in your subject. And that is why these key concepts are important. These may be the search terms that you put up in the YouTube search or the Google search. Some more guidelines. Keep the length of the video not more than 10 minutes. There are empirical evidences which says that shorter the video, greater the engagement. If you find that videos are too long, let's say you find an NPTEL video which is of one full class hour, what we would want is split the topic into multiple videos. So provide timelines where the videos can be split and chunked. One more guideline, the videos, ideally select videos which have both narration and text so that concepts would be clear to the students. So this is what you have to fill, the main video source URL, provide the URL over here, the license, what kind of license is it? If it is a copyright, a specific copyright, then you have to say that it is a copyrighted video. And you can map each concept with the appropriate video segment. So you can provide the start time and end time and duration in minutes. So this will help you in shortening the videos, and at the end of it, provide the total duration of the video. So if you look at the example that I have filled, you can see that I have shortened the URL. So I have given a bit.ly URL so that it is easy to remember. The license is CC by SA with reuse allowed. And I have mapped each of my key concepts with the video segments. So I had a total of a 45 minute video. So I looked at a complete session, lecture session by another instructor. And I have actually split into videos. So none of my videos are going beyond 7 minutes. Initially, it is very hard to find smaller chunks. So for a starter, this is advised. But as you go proceed, as you gain expertise, it is important that you reduce the video length to somewhere around 4 minutes. YouTube, Vimeo, all these sites also have these filters where you can select short, medium or long videos. Short video as per YouTube and Vimeo is something which is less than 4 minutes. Medium length comes in Vimeo, which is approximately 10 minutes, and longer videos are greater than 10 minutes. So a guideline while you do a video selection is select chunks which are not more than 10 minutes initially. Another important thing. So if you actually look at the videos that we have posted in IIT Bombay X, every learning dialogue video is followed by a learning by doing activity. And you can see there were like two or three learning by doing activities associated with a video. And each of these assessment activities are aligned to the learning objectives and are at lower levels. So it will be some content which was already discussed. The levels of questions is not more than apply. So it would be either simple recall, maybe a little bit about understanding what the instructor said or what the video said. At the most, it is application. Like for example, we would have given scenarios. There is this flipped classroom scenario A, there is flipped classroom scenario B, which one is better? So these are only application kind of questions that we have asked you. So again, we would recommend you to follow the same. It is important that there is some amount of assessment strategy that is aligned to these out of class segment. And you can put your video plus assessment, the total duration should not be more than one lecture hour. So over here, learning objective, what is the assessment strategy, expected duration in minutes, and if there are some additional instructions, you can provide it. If you look at the example, for each of the learning objective that I have provided, I have provided the assessment strategy, and I have also provided the instructions. So the total activity duration is 30 minutes for the expected duration is 30 minutes. And this along with I had another 31 minutes for my video watching. So total is 1 hour, 1 minute. That is fine. It should be around 1 hour. It should not exceed more than 1 hour. You have already looked at this. There is something called in-class segment where you have to decide what the active learning strategy is. Make sure that your in-class segment contains activities for effective learning. By this, we mean active learning strategies. In active learning strategy, the student will go beyond mere listening, copying of notes, or execution of prescribed procedures like problem solving, copying the what the instructor solved in the board. Students are required to talk, as you did during your pair phase, write and reflect, as you did in your think phase and pair phase, and express their thinking as you did in your share phase. It has to be, the activities have to engage the student in higher order thinking skills. So if you happen to look at the pros and cons analysis activity that you did in the morning, it actually, there were some trigger questions and you had to think a lot more than mere application of these questions. You had to completely analyze what the flipped classroom strategy A was about, and identify one pro and one con, and then discuss with your participants. So this is what you mean by higher order thinking. It goes beyond mere application. You have to do some amount of analysis. You also had to do an evaluation, which strategy was better. Sometimes there may be creation level activities, but not always. Typically in engineering problem solving, there are design problems which can lead to this create level activities. Another important guideline, ensure that students get feedback on their work either from peers or you. So during your pair phase, you obtain feedback from your peer. And during share phase, as instructors, we looked at specific questions and comments and we provided our feedback as a summary. And that is also another important point. Ensure to provide summary that connects out of class and in class activities. So remember what we said about the entire exercise. So we had abstracted the entire exercise of flipped classroom that we have done till now and connected both the out of class videos and the in class pros and cons analysis activity. So you should do similar, what do you say, summary in your own flipped classroom strategy so that students understand clearly why the out of class activities are important and why the in class activities are important and how they are connected. So in class activity design, again, you start with the learning objectives and the key concepts. So in this example, the learning objectives have been stated. Another important thing, both the learning objectives are at analyze level. The key concepts also vary. Over here, I am looking at real world problem solving, whereas in the videos, it was about simple expressions. Then if you see, another important is the activity design. You have to state the active learning strategy that you are going to do. It's not just that. Within the active learning strategy, what the teacher is going to do and what the student is going to do across the entire learning strategy. And finally, you have to justify why the above active learning strategy is truly active. So you have to give specific reasons as to how the student go beyond mere writing, listening to lecture and all those things. And you have to specifically say why this activity is going to engage them in higher order thinking. So if you look at the example that is given, the active learning strategy that is there in the example, I've used the active learning strategy of think, pair, share, as well as peer instruction. I have actually mentioned what each of these strategy is going to be used for. Think, pair, share for real world problem solving, and concept clarification, we use peer instruction. So these are peer instruction strategy questions. Now, I'm just explaining the TPS strategy because you have already come across the think, pair, share in the video. First, we provide the premise or the real world problem that we want to tackle. Over here, there are these four sensors. So each sensor has temperature and humidity sensors 1, 2, 3, 4. This is located in a big agricultural university, and there is a central hub over here, and they want to take some measurements. You have to assume that you have to assume that each information is passed as a digital signal, and there is a digital circuit that is kept at the central hub. So we'll be looking at the think phase question. Assuming that the temperature and humidity of a station are two Boolean variables, T and H, as given in the figure, think individually and identify the scenario in which a high output will occur from an area. If you look at this question, what the participant has to actually look at is identify one possible scenario where a high output will come. And this is actually doable for that particular target audience. So they would already be primed about how high inputs would be coming, what all should be stated as high input. So they'll be able to think about this task, and most of the students will be able to do this think activity. In the pair phase, again, you have been given a question, and what is select sensor output based on time, using two variables. So there are two other variables, A and B, and there is this sensor outputs that come in. Develop a Boolean expression to combine time selection and output selection. So they have to actually do something beyond just mere thinking. Pair up and compare your answers, agree on one final answer, and then do this particular task. So it's not just comparing the answer. They have been given one more additional task. So think phase had them to write what will become high. So there was a deliverable output. Now it has been connected to the pair phase, and in the pair phase also the level has been increased, and as a pair they have to come up with another output. And finally, in the share phase, the instructor asks the group to share their answer with the class and see whether there are different answers. So since the class might be very large, so instructor takes one answer, then asks others to see what all are the different other answers that are coming in, so that all the answers get shared. And after sharing is done, instructor gives feedback on the correct solution and how minimizations using Boolean expressions play. So there is this application of a concept in this particular topic, and he summarizes about how this concept is applied in this question and what all are, and he connects it to some real life applications like multiplexer. So there is some other real life circuit which actually does all this. So he is connecting this current knowledge to what is there in the future chapters of this particular course. Again, he does another iteration to find implementation and other things. So this is how typically, if you look at this think pair share, each of this is followed. Characteristic is that it is a doable task at each level, correct difficulty. There is a standard, a deliverable output that is demanded from the students at each phase, and thereby engage the students in the task. And I have justified why this is an active learning strategy towards the end. So you will be provided with this during the lab session, where we will give you specific instructions. You will have to complete the in-class segment of this flipped classroom activity constructor during today's lab session, which comes in the afternoon.
Okay. What we'll do now is keep the flipped classroom activity constructor itself. We have enabled the download this presentation, so you can also download it within your RCs. In the lab in the afternoon, we'll focus mostly on the out-of-class component. In the next half an hour or so, we'll actually focus on the in-class component, which you have already seen to some extent in the last 1 week. So to begin, I'll just use this activity constructor to help you format or organize the activity. Let's go to slide 4. So the first part of what you need to do now is to actually get ready, get primed to create a flipped classroom design for one of your own courses that you will be teaching in the coming semester. One big goal for us for this faculty development program is that you not just learn about these new techniques or get familiar, but actually create materials which are going to be practically useful for you as soon as possible. When we run this course during the semesters, we actually ask the participants to work with a topic that they'll be teaching the following week, go implement it, come back and give us feedback. So that may not be possible now, but at least we want you to create assignments that you'll use very soon. So in order to do this, the first thing you will need to do for this activity is find a partner. If you look at the next slide, slide 5, you have to fill in the topic chosen for the activity, the course, the domain, target audience, UGPG, which year, affiliation and so on. So you must try very hard to find somebody from the same broad domain, and try if possible at all to find somebody who teaches a similar course. The closer the topic for you and your partner is, then the easier this activity will be. So quickly just check around in your remote centers and try to find somebody with whom you think you'll be able to write a common set of responses for this slide, for the topic and so on. So I'm going to give you about 2 minutes to do this. Get up, walk around, ask people. Same domain, definitely, and preferably same course. This is a pair activity, and then two pairs will join and do some more things. So you can't work on this individually. As soon as you find a partner, please fill up this introductory slide. So write down the topic, course, domain. You can actually go bottom up. What's the domain? You don't have to put the affiliation right now, but what's your domain, what's the target audience, course, and so on. And start filling out this introductory slide, because this sets the background for both the lab this afternoon as well as the upcoming activity.
So currently you can write it in your notebooks if you don't need to actually go and write in the slide. So make sure you write it in your notebook and find people from similar domains. Since you are in the same remote center and you might be familiar with other participants over there, it will be quite easy. We expect that it will be easier for you. At a broad level, find people from same domain.
We really hope that you take advantage of this face-to-face part of the blended course. During the online sessions, you were all separated in time and distance. You were working at your homes or offices on individual PCs or laptops. So now that you're physically together with somewhere between 5 and maybe even 100 participants in your RC. Please take advantage of that.
We encourage the coordinators to ensure that this grouping happens. This will be further useful for you in the future weeks of this workshop, where you have to submit a team assignment. And this will be one place where you can think of what, how, who all will be your team members, what will be the benefits in that case. So the entire activity, there is a design and a peer review, so it will help you actually form a team right from the start. And you can actually go through this entire workshop as a team.
Okay, well, it looks like many of you have found partners. Please spend another 3 to 5 minutes filling out this slide, especially the topic and course. The reason it's important to spend some time here is that you will be sticking with this topic not just for the next 1 hour when we do this activity, but also for the lab today and tomorrow. So choose an activity. The point is, pick a topic for which you will design a flipped classroom for your own course. So about 3 minutes, we'll keep quiet till then.
So this is a pair activity, not an individual activity. Find a pair. So it could be even 2 or 3, but not more than 3.
Okay, so I'll just give you a brief set of guidelines on what you will do in the next 15 minutes. And if you haven't finished this particular slide, we will you can come back to this. So domain is your subject. Course is the actual paper that you're teaching. No? So domain can be, for example, electrical engineering, and the course can be something like analog electronics. Okay, or domain can be computer science, and course can be data structures. Okay, so what we will focus on now is actually the in-class segment. And since you have become somewhat familiar with think-pair-share, we'll actually go directly to a think-pair-share activity. The goal for the next 10 minutes or 15 minutes, let's say, is in a pair with your partner, create a think-pair-share activity for the learning objective that you will write and the key concepts related to the learning objective. So the goal of this activity, part A, is to create a think-pair-share activity. There is a part B that will come up. I'll give guidelines only after we finish part A. Part B has to do with this guideline on slide 20, which says that ensure that students get feedback on their work either from peers or from you. So at this point, you're the learners. So all the participants. So you will do a peer review session after you create the think-pair-share to get feedback on your own work. So right now, let's just focus on the actual work, on the actual creation. So fill in slide number 5, which has domain, topic, course and all. Then jump directly to slide 21. Slide 22 is an example, you can look at it. And after slide 22, please go to slide number 27 onwards. So 27, 28, 29, the example is provided, and you have to replace the example by your own activity. You can write this in notebook or text file, anyhow you want. So 3 phases, think phase, short 2-minute activity which learners can just, all learners can do. Pair phase, where each pair compares an answer or critiques each other's work or comes up with something together. And a share phase, where the entire class has to be involved.
So this group formation, it is not the formal group formation of this workshop. It is only for this activity. You may continue with the same group across the workshop. It is up to you. But for this act, you don't need to give us group details or any other things. It is only for activity for today's face-to-face session. Why having similar domains is important is because to get reviews and to design activity, people from same domain will be able to make, convince each other, try to find some loopholes in the design, provide you with constructive feedback. So the feedback that you get from the peer is useful if the peer is from the same domain. More useful if the peer is from the same domain.
Yeah, so let's go on till about 12:20 or so, and then we'll start the review session.